We thank our Madam Minister for the insightful views. We must tell her that the focus on technology is something which definitely this group will appreciate. We as alums do believe in leveraging technology to best utilize our resources, scant resources, and to achieve multifold results. Thank you, Madam, for sparing the time for us. It is now our opportunity to hear our very own chairperson, and as some would say, the beacon of India's medical fraternity, Dr. Devi Shetty. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Harish, for the opportunity. And once again, I'm extremely grateful to the organizers for the giving me this platform to interact with all of you. COVID has disrupted our life completely beyond recognition. Unfortunately, it is not going to go away in the next few days or months or even years. We don't know. Is there anything we can do to prepare ourselves to fight against COVID? I would like to quote a very famous statement by Benjamin Franklin. By failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail. We need to prepare ourselves. We need to prepare ourselves for the possible third wave. Second wave, as you know, is more or less plateaued, and it's a matter of time before it goes down. What about the next third wave? Nobody can predict whether there is going to be a third wave, but we all should assume that there is going to be a third wave. Nobody can predict how serious this third wave is going to be, but we all should accept that it will be as bad or even worse than what it was in the past waves. So we need to prepare ourselves. Now, is there anything different than the second wave and the first wave? That is, possibly there can be one difference. There is a possibility that children may get infected slightly more than what we are seeing. But we all have seen that when children get infected with COVID, they do not experience the similar catastrophic symptoms what the adults experience. It is unlikely to be anything very serious, but the problem is we have very little infrastructure to take care of the children if they ever fall sick. So we need to prepare ourselves for that eventuality. Thanks to many state governments and the initiative of the central government warning all the state governments about this possibility, every state government is now preparing a separate task force to face this possibility if it ever happens. Vaccination is the cheapest and the safest and the best protection against COVID-19. It has now proven beyond doubt that people who are vaccinated are definitely more protected than the ones who are not. In our experience of working in hospitals, especially the hospital where I am working, at any given time, we used to get 500 to 700 COVID patients. And our intensivists keep saying that not many they have seen in the ICU who received two injections of COVID vaccine. That's a great news. But how many people are having the access, or some people having the desire to get vaccinated? It is very, very important that the earliest possible opportunity, please vaccinate yourself. But we have a very important message. When you vaccinate yourself, obviously you can afford to pay for the vaccine. Please kindly look at someone who cannot afford to pay for the vaccine. Today, situation is dramatically different than the past. Last week, a friend of mine called me saying that, okay, there is a lot of hardship in India. I want to help the poor in villages. How can I go about it? Then I reminded him that Today, a lot of poor are in cities, in the slums of India. In the last 1 year, maids have lost jobs. People working in restaurants have lost their jobs. Construction workers have lost their jobs. There is a lot of hardship. Even if you say that the vaccine costs per injection 800 rupees or 1,000 rupees, you're talking about two injections, and a family of four for two injections, it costs 10 to 12,000 rupees, which is a lot of money. So my humble request with all of you, when you get yourself vaccinated or when you pay for the vaccination of your loved ones, please think about people who are not as privileged as us and kindly contribute something for their vaccination. With this, believe me, you are not only protecting yourself by directly vaccinating, by vaccinating the rest of the country, you are in a much better position to fight this war. Because if we allow this COVID epidemic to continue, and if we do not control it, as the time passes by, more and more resistant strains of virus will emerge. And then the worst thing can happen. That is, people who are already infected can get reinfected, or people who are vaccinated can also get infected. So to protect yourself and the society, please help the others who are not as privileged as us. So I would like to congratulate Give India, the foundation which has collected hundreds of crores of rupees ever since the COVID pandemic started. We have partnered with them. Our concept is very simple. We are getting COVID vaccine from Covishield Serum Institute for 600 rupees. 30 rupees of GST, it comes to 630 rupees. We are offering vaccine to all the rich and poor who comes to our hospital at 630, and we don't charge any money for vaccination. But in turn, we expect all of you, when you receive your vaccine, kindly donate at least 630 or 1,000 rupees or whatever you can to Give India. The money you donate, Give India in turn will procure the vaccine, and they will distribute it to various hospitals for vaccinating the poor. Going in this direction, we are optimistic that within the next few months, we should be able to vaccinate most of the Indians. Now, talking about preparing our country for the future epidemic or a robust healthcare system, everyone thinks for that we need to build more hospitals. Building hospital is not going to solve the problem. In the last 4 or 5 years, very few hospitals have come up. Hardly any hospital has come up in tier 2, tier 3 cities. Why? Mainly because it is not the cost of building the hospital which is preventing people from building the hospital. Where are the doctors? Where are the nurses? Where are the technicians? Unless we liberate medical, paramedical, nursing education, there is no healthcare delivery in the years to come. Today, we are struggling to offer healthcare to the COVID patients in our hospital because we are terribly short of doctors, nurses, and medical technicians. What do we need to do? It's very, very simple solution we have. All we have to do is to ask every hospital with over 100 beds to start a nursing college. Nursing education, medical education is an apprenticeship. You don't need the Taj Mahal-like creation of an institution to educate doctors, nurses, and medical technicians. You just need a good hospital filled with the skilled and compassionate doctors. So we need to encourage as many hospitals as possible to start the nursing colleges. Now, you may wonder, oh, it's such an easy task. It is not easy. I am well connected and I have many friends in the high places in many, many state governments. In one particular state, we have a hospital with over 300 beds, one of the most successful hospitals in that state. last 5 years, I've been trying to start a nursing college. Ironically, I'm in the committee of many committees advising the state government, but still I couldn't start a nursing college. It is so complicated. So if we can liberate the nursing education, we will have efficient nurses. I just want to give all of you a message. You may think that it's the doctors who run the hospital and it's the doctors who take care of the patient. You are mistaken. When you are critically unwell in the critical care unit, doctors do not even spend 1% of your time in the hospital, in the ICU near your bedside. It is the nurses who are standing there beside near your bed 24 hours in shifts. You probably may not have noticed, there is no chair provided in the ICU for the nurses to sit. They stand for 8 hours, 12 hours continuously. And they are the ones who will make a difference between life and death. So it is very important that the nursing training programs should be streamlined. They should be empowered. It is a pathetic situation in India. In US, a nurse anesthetist who's trained as a nurse and then as an anesthetist for 2 or 3 years is allowed to anesthetize a critically ill patient for a heart operation. Whereas in India, her counterparts who worked in the critical care unit for 20 years is legally not allowed to prescribe even a painkiller tablet. Unless we allow career progression for the nurses, give them the dignity and matching remuneration, you will never be able to transform healthcare. Now, about the doctors, we need to double the number of medical seats in the country. And we need to do it without spending even 1 rupee extra. How is it possible? It is possible because existing medical colleges, which has an intake of 100 or 120 or 150 students, has a massive infrastructure. They have hundreds of faculty members, 20 acres of land. And this is the only country where such rigid regulation exists. And they train only 50 or 100 students. All we have to do is allow them to take additional 100 students. Believe me, even if you practice the global standards, they can easily take more than 200 students. Let's be very conservative. If the existing colleges take 100 students, if we have 500 medical colleges, we create 50,000 additional medical seats to be given purely on merit, we would have doubled the number of medical seats. Now, where do they get the clinical experience? Post them in 660 district hospitals of the country. When these medical students go to the district hospital, and the faculty, the local doctors become part-time visiting teachers, dramatic changes will happen. The district hospital will become vibrant and medical students will get large number of patients to learn from, and the entire healthcare scenario of the country will change. And the last thing we need to do is to have micro health insurance, which people can download in their mobile phone and pay for it on a monthly basis. If we do these three things, we will become the first country in the world to dissociate healthcare from affluence. Thank you once again for this opportunity.